Welcome to the first lecture in Module 8. In Module 8, we're going to be looking at a number of different approximations for quantum mechanics. This first lecture, we'll be talking about first-order perturbation theory, and we're going to be deriving it through a technique called the Feynman-Hellmann Theorem. So I want to start by letting you know why it is we need approximations. And we have solved a lot of problems in quantum mechanics already. It's at least a dozen, maybe even more. But not all problems that you might be interested in can be solved exactly. In fact, most quantum problems cannot be solved exactly. And then if you wanted to solve it, you'd have to do something numerically, typically. But there's another thing that you can try. If there is a exactly solvable model that is not too different from the model you're trying to solve, you can think about perturbing the exactly solvable model in such a way that you can determine the properties of the solution. So we want to develop different kinds of approximation methods. There is one approximation method we've already encountered. That was the variational method. Although in the way in which we used it, we didn't use it as an approximation yet. The way that you would use the variational method as an approximation is you would create some variational wave function that depends on some parameters. You would calculate the expectation value of the energy, and then you would minimize the expectation value of the energy by finding the values of the parameters that give you the lowest possible energy. And then you have a good approximation for the ground state of the system that you are looking at. Now, the other technique besides the variational principle is called perturbation theory. And really, you should just think of this as a Taylor series expansion in the energy and in the wave functions away from some unperturbed result, like perhaps the simple harmonic oscillator, or perhaps something like the solutions of hydrogen and so forth. So I'm going to start by showing you how you can think about things using the variational method. And we're going to be solving a problem that we can solve exactly, but we're going to treat it as if we couldn't solve it exactly and then see how we solve it in an approximate fashion using these different approximation methods. And then, of course, because we can solve it exactly, we have a nice check. So what we're going to do is we're going to take the simple harmonic oscillator where you shift the spring constant. Now, we've been focusing primarily on thinking about the simple harmonic oscillator's potential as 1/2 m omega squared, but I could just as well write it as 1/2 kx squared, recalling that the frequency omega is the square root of k over m. And then if I shift the spring constant and perturb it by shifting it by delta k, delta being a number times k, which was the original spring constant, then I'll get this perturbed Hamiltonian that we'll call h of delta, which is p hat squared over 2m plus 1/2 k, 1 plus delta x hat squared. Now, the exact energy we know, because it's h bar omega square root of k, which is now k times 1 plus delta divided by m. Square root of k over m is omega, so I get h bar omega times the square root of 1 plus delta times n plus 1/2. This is all possible energy eigenvalues. So as I had said before, we know that the exact energy is given by this h bar omega square root of 1 plus delta times n plus 1/2, where omega is equal to the square root of k over m. And if I expand that square root of 1 plus delta in a Taylor series expansion, and you should try to do this yourself to make sure that you know how to do that, we find that the energy at delta is given by En of 0 times 1 plus 1/2 delta minus 1/8 delta squared plus 1/16 delta cubed and so forth. The expansion, of course, has an infinite number of terms. Now, our claim is we can calculate the first order term in that expansion, the 1/2 delta term, using this variational method. And the idea is that we simply take the expectation value with respect to the eigenstates of the unperturbed Hamiltonian. So we just take that function, En of delta, and we take the expectation value of En of delta with the unperturbed eigenfunctions. Now, you might have thought because all we're doing is we're shifting delta, we're shifting the spring constant by delta, that the eigenfunctions are the same. But they're not, because if you think about it, the subsidiary condition depends on omega, and we're changing omega. So the unperturbed wave functions are not the eigenfunctions of the full Hamiltonian. So what we're doing is we're now looking at the expectation value of this H of delta in those unperturbed wave functions, with respect to the unperturbed wave functions. And this is the way that you would do the variational calculation. Now, we can separate out. We have an H of 0 plus a V. That's what you have written on the top line. We always call the perturbation V. Our V is 1/2 K delta X squared. And the expectation value of the H of 0, that just gives me the EN of 0. So the first term is the EN of 0. Then I have a term that's proportional to delta, and it has this expectation value of the potential energy. So now we have to go back and remember, we've already calculated that. We know the virial theorem. So the virial theorem says that the expectation value of the kinetic energy is equal to the expectation value of the potential energy for the simple harmonic oscillator. And that means they're each equal to 1/2 the total energy. So I just say that that's equal to 1/2 that initial energy, En of 0. And now I can plug that into my formula for the variational energy. And what we find is we get the variational energy, En of delta, is En of 0 plus delta over 2 times En of 0. I can factor that En of 0 out. I get 1 plus delta over 2. And you see that's exactly what the first order term in the expansion is. So this is giving us the correct first order term in the perturbation theory when we do this approximation using the variational method. So the first question you might ask is this a fluke? I mean, we just looked at one particular example. That's not a proof that this is a general result. And to answer that, we have to look at something called the Feynman-Hellmann theorem. Now, the Feynman-Hellmann theorem tells us what happens to a matrix element when we take the derivative. And in particular, when we take the derivative of a matrix element that gives us an energy with respect to some parameter in the Hamiltonian. So if my Hamiltonian depends on some parameter, like the kinetic energy depends on mass, or the Coulomb interaction depends on E squared, or I can just introduce a parameter like we do with Feynman integration. If it depends on a parameter in the Hamiltonian, then I take a derivative with respect to that, and that's going to be related to the derivative of the energy with respect to the parameter. So the way that we're going to do this, we're going to just calculate the derivative. So recall that I can write the energy E of lambda as psi of lambda, H hat of lambda, psi of lambda, when psi of lambda is an eigenfunction of h of lambda. So as long as h of lambda acting on psi of lambda is equal to e of lambda, and psi of lambda is a normalized wave function, then e of lambda is just equal to the sandwich psi of lambda, h of lambda, psi of lambda. And if I want the derivative of that, I just take the derivative of both sides. So we get dE of lambda d lambda equals this derivative of that whole expression on the right-hand side. Now, we just use the chain rule to calculate that expression. And doing that calculation, we have three terms. We have the derivative of the bra, we have the derivative of the Hamiltonian, and we have the derivative of the ket. So there are three terms that we have to calculate. What we're going to do is we're going to see that, look, in that derivative of the bra term, I have an h acting on psi, so I can use the eigenvalue relationship to call that E of lambda times psi, and then E of lambda is a number, I can pull it out, and I have a derivative of the bra times the ket, and the same thing happens with the other term, the derivative of the ket. I can let the H act on the bra and pull out the En of lambda. And now what you see is if I factor out that En of lambda times those two terms, I actually have the derivative of the bra ket psi of lambda. But the bra ket psi of lambda is equal to 1 because it's normalized. And the derivative of a constant is 0. So that term's gone. And then this expression is what we call the Feynman-Hellmann theorem. It says that the derivative of the energy expectation value, or the energy as a function of lambda, is given by the expectation value of the derivative of the Hamiltonian with respect to lambda. Now, sometimes people think that this is obvious, but of course, since we went through this derivation, we showed we had to cancel two of the terms in the derivative, it's clearly not an obvious result. All right, so this tells us what the first term in our Taylor series expansion is, because the derivative, if I write my Hamiltonian h of delta is h of 0 plus delta times v, then en of delta is en of 0 plus delta times dE of delta d delta that at delta equals 0. That's just the Taylor series expansion. And then the Feynman-Hellmann theorem tells us that that derivative of the energy with respect to delta at delta equals 0 is just delta times the expectation value of sine of 0 v sine of 0, where sine of 0 was the eigenstate when delta equals 0. And of course, that's our unperturbed eigenstate. So you can see that this is exactly what we were getting from that variational approximation. And so the Feynman-Hellmann theorem can be used to prove that the first order perturbation theory follows simply from this variational expression. All right, we're going to be applying this to a very non-trivial and very important problem, the hyperfine structure of hydrogen. That's going to be what we're going to be doing during the classwork, and it allows us to compute what's called the hyperfine structure of hydrogen. This tells us what the difference is in the ground state energy, because the ground state has an electron that has spin 1/2, which interacts with a nucleus that has spin 1/2, and that interaction changes the energy, and we get two energy levels rather than a single energy level. And the transition that you have between those two energy levels is an extremely important transition in radio astronomy, because the state is very long-lived. Its lifetime is something like 10 million years. We can determine very precisely what the Doppler shift is for that transition line, and that allows us to determine how far different objects are in the universe using the redshift. Now, a second problem that we're going to look at now with the Feynman-Hellmann theorem is to calculate the inverse squared moment of the position, the radial position coordinate in the hydrogen wave functions, the NL wave functions. In problem 5 of problem set 11, which I know you might not have finished yet, we calculate the positive moments of r hat in these hydrogen wave functions using a recurrence relation that was worked out by Kramers and Pasternak. If we try to extend the recurrence relation for negative moments, we find that we run into a problem, because one of the coefficients of one of the terms vanishes, and it stops the recurrence relation. And the only way to get the recurrence relation to go again requires us to compute this inverse second moment of the radial position in these different hydrogen energy eigenstate wave functions. So in most textbooks, this is done via the Feynman-Hellmann theorem, and I'm going to show you how that works next. Now, you may be troubled by this calculation. I know I'm troubled by this calculation. There's an assumption in it that I find somewhat fishy, and that's why we're going to redo this calculation in the homework using operators. But we will find that the actual result is correct. So I want you to recall for hydrogen that we can write the Hamiltonian in each angular momentum sector, H sub L, as the radial momentum squared divided by 2m plus h bar squared L times L plus 1 over 2m r squared minus e squared over r. And the energy eigenfunctions satisfy hL acting on the state nL is given by en times the state nL. Now, the Feynman-Hellmann theorem says, let's generalize this. Let's not work with an L, but let's work with a lambda. So we're going to call this h of lambda, and the only thing I'm doing is switching L with lambda. We actually did something very similar to this when we were doing the Cartesian factorization for hydrogen. Now, the claim is that the energy expressed as a function of lambda for this can be written as em of lambda is equal to minus e squared over 2a0 m plus lambda plus 1 quantity squared, where we're using a similar notation to what we've used before. M is indicating the mth excited state above the ground state for a given, if you like, angular momentum sector, or a given lambda value. Now, in principle, we can apply the Feynman-Hellmann theorem to this, but what bothers me, and I hope would bother you, is that when we were doing the solutions, we insisted that L was an integer, so taking a derivative of something that we insisted was an integer seems like it could be problematic. However, if you look carefully at problem 3 of problem set 11, it does suggest that this is an okay thing to do. So, after you've solved problem 3 of problem set 11, you should also verify, or be able to verify, that from the results that we did there, this form of the energy in terms where m is that index that indicates the mth excited state is a valid form. So now we have these two forms. We have a lambda in the Hamiltonian. We have a lambda in the energy. We just differentiate both sides to apply Feynman-Hellmann. So let's go ahead and do that calculation. The derivative of the energy will give me a minus 2 factor, and it will give a cube down there at the bottom. And the derivative of the Hamiltonian, I have a lambda squared plus lambda. When I take that derivative, I'll get 2 lambda plus 1. So you see here, this is what we get. Now we're going to be collecting some terms and doing some simplifications. M plus lambda plus 1, that was the principal quantum number, so we can replace that by n. We can recognize that when we bring all the constants to the left-hand side, I will have an e squared over h bar squared, e squared m over h bar squared, but that's 1 over a0, so I'll get a 1 over a0 squared, and then I can bring the 2 over 2 lambda plus 1, but we have to evaluate, we're going to be evaluating this in the case where lambda goes to l. So what you see, we're going to get 1 over a0 squared n cubed l plus a half. And indeed, that is the exact result for what the expectation value of the inverse squared moment is in a hydrogenic wave function, or hydrogenic energy eigenstate. You do have a problem set where you're going to calculate this using operators, so you can be 100% sure that this really works. This now brings us to the end of the first lecture of Module 8.